we said a little bit earlier on, we're going to be hearing from some of the islanders soon via Skype from the capital, Stanley.
Yes, also here is Suki Cameron, the Falklands Islands representative in the UK, herself a third-generation islander.
And Argentinian Celia Susterman, an academic specialising in Latin American history and politics. Now, Celia, as we heard there in the film, quite a strong reaction from an Argentinian point of view with the arrival of Prince William. Now, that's not how it was reported over here.
No, but in Argentina it was seen as a provocation because he was arriving in a military uniform. And therefore the problem is that Argentina's perception of what happens in the UK and the role of the royal family and so on is a bit distorted. So it was it went down very badly.
But I mean, he's just a serviceman, and if he was arriving in a military uniform, then...
No, of course, but that sounds very normal and very natural, seen from here. But from over there, it was seen as some kind of provocation, I'm afraid.
Okay.
Okay, all right.
What is the sort of the basis of their superior claim on, as they call them, Las Malvinas? Why, I mean, it's 350 miles off their coast, which is outside their international waters. It's entirely populated by British citizens who
Well, not
entirely citizens, but they've got a right to self-determination, and they like being under the connection with Britain. So what's the Argentinian case then? I can never quite understand it.
Well, it's mostly a historical case, and it's based on the fact that in 1833 there was a group of Argentines living on the islands with their own sort of government appointed from Buenos Aires, and in 1833 they were ceremoniously told to leave. So that, from 1833, marks the point when Argentina feels that it was usurped and the land was taken away.
It is disputed, but they don't...
It's really the islands today that are important.
It's the islands today. It's about 3,000 people are there today, really, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, exactly.
We've got Roddy, we've got Pippa, and we've got Stacey over in the Falkland Islands now. So guys, how connected do you feel to Britain? I mean, you are 8,000 miles away. Stacey, we'll start with you.
Yeah, we feel very connected. We have our culture is totally British. We enjoy watching British television programmes, and we feel very connected to the outside world and as British as can be.
Yeah. Pippa, you three are public servants, but is there anybody there then that's keen on Argentinian rule? There must be some.
I can't think of anyone who really is. At the moment, it seems that the Argentine government doesn't recognise that Falkland Islands people should have a say in what happens to the way they're governed in their future, and doesn't seem to recognise that we do govern our own affairs here and make our own laws and determine how our economy develops and how we spend the money that we earn from our resources. So it's hard to believe that if we were governed by Argentina, they would recognise our rights then. So it's something that people don't really want to contemplate.
And Roddy, as we understand, Argentina does place you under a few restrictions anyway. So what is it actually like living out there under those restrictions and constraints?
Our day-to-day lives haven't really changed that much. I mean, the price of fresh vegetables and fresh produce has increased a bit. But, I mean, we're a fairly resourceful people, so... Find ways around it. I mean, it has affected some businesses, but again, nothing that's going to stop our way of life anyway.
But will it change if they take sovereignty then, do you think?
Absolutely, it would change completely.
Okay.
Well, we heard there, Cindy, that Pippa was saying that she doesn't know of anybody that would, you know,
Is
that the case as far as you're concerned? Or?
Yes, as far as I'm concerned, that is the case. And I have to say that I don't agree that the islanders' views should not be taken into account. That is not a position that I hold. And there have been Argentine governments in the past who were interested in understanding the point of view of the islanders.
But don't people who take an interest, aren't they just using it though for kind of political capital to whip up a bit of kind of support at home, and they don't really have any regard for the 3,000 people that kind of live there? They'd rather look at the rights of a handful of people that were there 180 years ago and not the rights of 3,000 people who are there now.
Well, that is a point, and that is why there is a dispute, and ideally people should be talking to one another and come to some kind of agreement.
How do you think this will all wrap up, Suki?
Well, we had a fairly good relationship with the Argentines in the 1990s. we had agreements over fisheries, hydrocarbons, communications, that sort of thing, and sadly the current the Argentine government have ripped those up. So we don't really know what will happen with future relations with Argentina, but our sovereignty is not for negotiation. We are British, and that's how we're going to stay.
Well, with the 30th anniversary approaching and MPs planning to visit the Falklands in the coming weeks, it certainly is an issue that is far from over. Thanks to everybody for getting involved in that. Cheers.
Thank you very much. Now, shortly, we'll be talking to you, Jonny, about digging in mud.
So I'm still quite stirred by your words there.
Absolutely.
But what you should have done, instead of digging in mud, you probably should have looked down the drains.
Yes.
You'll see now, aren't you?
Imagine you're going about an honest day's graft and you stumble across this, a £21,000 Rolex watch abandoned in a drain. Do you put it on your wrist and keep your...
I was quite surprised by it because he found a Rolex first, a gold Rolex, Daytona Cosmograph, which are very fashionable watches at the moment. But on every single Rolex, below 6 o'clock, in between the bits where the strap goes, which is called the lugs, in between there is a serial number, which will give you the exact year of the watch. Yeah. And then at the top of the watch, there, above the 12 o'clock lugs, each watch has a serial number. So when you buy one, you register with Rolex, so they can trace every single watch. Yeah. So it should be actually a really easy job for them to find out. I hope he's not watching the King. Cheers for telling me.
Now you've just completely wrecked everything.
But they can follow the sort of the provenance and the line of it. So I'm quite sort of surprised. He found a Frank Muller one there, and they're even more kind of fun.
It seems to me you're very attracted to things. Is that where the whole of Mud Men comes from?
I'm very attracted to Steve. I was just attracted to, I guess the feeling of treasure is what's nice.
Treasure, yeah.
If you haven't seen the show, 10 o'clock Thursdays on History, it's an expert, which is Steve, and an enthusiast, which is me, down the foreshore of the Thames, really digging history, just digging up things. Steve's allowed to go down the meter. I've only got a 3-inch license.
Right.
I can only go in 3 inches.
Shall we see that 3-inch license?
Yeah. You want to see my 3-inch license?
Here it is.
It's okay at this time.
And your hero, Steve, is here with a tray full of treasure.
Is my hero here?
Come on in, Steve.
Oh, did I ever tell you you're my...
Nice and white and clean, everything.
Yeah, I've got to say, the tray came from you, the items came from Steve Brooker, ladies and gentlemen. Steve in the house.
Steve.
He's here now.
They wouldn't let me through security, that's why I'm lying.
Really? This is the chain mail that you were talking about there, then, Steve, yes?
This is how it came out, so.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Is it live? So, this is the
bomb. That's
the
bomb.
Bomb.
Yeah.
So, this.
Boom!
When you found it, it was unexploded, wasn't it?
Just feel the weight of
that
bomb.
Yeah.
So this is how it comes out. As you saw on the film, it comes to the surface, it stops to erode down and everything. But of course, if you catch it in that anaerobic mud, it looks like this.
Anaerobic mud means the oxygen can't get in there. That's why the Thames perfectly preserves everything we dig up.
You work well together. Steve says one bit and then you...
So we've seen the chair now. We've got what, pipes and all sorts here? Are there personal here in yours?
Well, Steve, if you can tell anyone, if they go down the foreshore of the Thames, anyone will see these clay pipes. Got you pick up that. These are everywhere, because obviously they used to go down a bit like cigarette ends, sort of now outside places, so everyone used to have these. The stems have got longer and longer, the bowls got bigger and bigger as more tobacco came in. Steve, how old's the one you've got there?
Well, this is about 1580, so when tobacco first comes in, of course it's mega expensive. Mm.
Is it mega expensive?
Mega expensive.
Charles,
that's how tobacco is.
It was absolutely mega down there. It was going to be massive. Go on.
You can see why it's such a good show.
No, go on. But Steve's right, it's a tiny bowl there.
Yeah, and then in the 1800s, it's in abundance.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also, quite a fashion statement as well. You know, we could have a bowl, you know, we could have a stem out to here, we have a church warden right out to here.
Steve, we've got 30 seconds left. Yeah. In your expert way, can you just whip round that tray very quickly?
This is the most interesting thing there, really.
No, I've done that one before in here before. Okay. What, Tudor padlock?
Tudor padlock? A Tudor
padlock?
Hurts the teeth.
How long would that have been there? Yeah, we're looking 400 years plus. But look, because of the anaerobic mud, it's in perfect condition.
How many padlocks do you own, Steve?
3,000.
He's got 3,000 padlocks.
16th century window. And this is...
window?
Yeah, this is something that's recently come up by Woolies John.
Yeah. Did Woolies John have that?
Yeah.
He's a man, he's an enigma, he refuses to talk on camera.
It's amazing. Can I just hold that?
Yeah, the foreshore, extremely dangerous. Great place to go, but you need to know what you're doing down there. There's lots of ordnance down there.
Well, I tell you what, we could go on and on and on and on.
Steve, where's that bomb from?
You hold the bomb, with
me. You hold the bomb, and that's it.
The Mud Men is on the History Channel tonight at 10 p.m.
Yes. Okay. And it's good entertainment, actually.
Yeah.
There you are. I think we've seen that.